First thing we learn in school is counting, using our fingers, and do elementary arithmetic with counting. So you introduce positive integers. First integer is 1, and 1 plus 1 is 2, 3, etc. And then for no number, you introduce the symbol 0. Then you learn addition and multiplication. Learn that A plus B is B plus A, AB equals to B. Introduce negative numbers, minus 1, minus 2, and to learn and learn to mark them on the line. In the schools we simply call number line, whatever the name, so 0 and then 1, 2, 3, etc. At the same time, to draw the line, you learn to use a ruler, a straight edge, with that you can draw segments of any arbitrary line by repetition. And then you soon learn to use the compass. So the ruler and compass become instruments. There are no markings on the ruler. Choose with the compass some arbitrary unit and keeping the origin, placing the needle of the compass here, then with the pencil you mark 1, then move the needle here and then you mark 2, and 3, and so on. I have forgotten about all this, but for my grandson I got to teach him how to do this, so this is how in his school numbers are, they are taught how to mark the numbers, and then going backward with the same compass, they are allowed to mark minus 1, minus 2, etc. And then given a segment, they are in the schools nowadays, they teach how to divide a segment in an equal number of parts. Suppose it is 3 parts, then you, with the set square, you draw a line perpendicular to this. The drawing you can do without the set square also, you can draw perpendicular with ruler and compass. And then mark here 1, arbitrarily equal. You mark the length here and then you repeat this with the compass, the same thing and this. Then this is, mark this as 0 and call this as 1. So you join this. And then you are taught how to draw parallels to this. And so this number is 1 by 3. And 2 by 3 and 3, which is 1. So thus you learn to mark all fractions of the form A by B, by A and B by B. So on the one hand, with hand, ruler and compass, you learn to mark the ration, what are called the rational numbers. Number is said to be rational if it can be expressed as A by B. A and B are integers. A by B and C by D are considered to be same if A, D equal to B, C. And you know in higher mathematics, you say that whenever two ratios of this form have the property that A, D equal to B, C, say they are equivalent or equivalent crosses, then it becomes a little more abstract. which is good enough for introducing a rudimentary concept of Rakshanatma. Then one learns to go beyond the rational. But because there is counting, all numbers of the form A by B, A and B are integer, they can actually be counted. Because this is a pair of integers, you can write, see, 1 by 1, 2 by 1, 3 by 1. So let me mark only the positive integer, positive number. And 1 by 2, 2 by 2, 3 by 2, and you go on doing that. Then to count all these numbers, you are taught how to, you just go by this procedure, then go down and then go this way, then go this way, go this way. Then you can, you count in this order, and you can count, in principle you can count all proportions, all fractions. So this is a set where you can enumerate all the fraction. Then you learn about something about triangles and circles. And when you come to triangles, you learn about right angle triangles. Right angle triangles. And here we are taught the first basic result, namely Pythagoras theorem. There is an ancient Indo-Chinese proof for the Pythagoras theorem, which is interesting. So you take a square, a distance x here and this distance is, the remaining distance is y. Then you mark the same x, y, the same x here and this is y, the same x here and this is y. Then you join and see properly. Join this, join this, join this, join this. Now you see this is a right angle triangle, this is x and this is y. So if you rotate this, this triangle can be placed on this. And if you, so these four triangles are congruent to each other. That is, one can be placed on the other to match. So these four triangles are common. Now this distance, this length of this segment is x plus y, and so the area of the big square is x plus y whole square. And remove this from this, cut off these four triangles, and four times, the area of this triangle, you know, is base into multiplied by 2, so 4 will be xy. So this is x square plus y square. So the shaded area here is x square plus y square. Suppose this length is z. Because these three, four triangles are congruent, all the sides are equal. And you get a square because this plus this is 90 degrees, because this plus this is 90 degrees. So this is a right angle and all the four sides are equal. So this is a square. And if this side is z, this is equal to z square. So, if this is x and this is y, hypotenuse square into the x square. Apparently, this is found in some old palm leaves in India, and also written on bones, bone sections in China. These are old, two folder data. So you know Pythagoras theorem, and this Pythagoras theorem introduces a very strange number. Suppose I have a unit here, unit length here and unit length here, and this is a right angle triangle. And this length is the ruler. So this length is 1 and this length is 1. So you have 1 square plus 1 square, that is equal to 2. So this is 1 square plus 1 square equals 2. So the theorem you will prove here is the square root of 2. This length is square root of 2. And Pythagoras proved that root 2 cannot be a number of the form a by b, where a and b are integers. And his proof is extremely simple. Root 2 into a over b. Suppose this is true, that a and b are integers. Suppose this is true. So this is the 3,000-year-old mathematics, right? 2 into a square by b square. Or a square equal to 2 b square. Well, all these are integers, so a squared is even. A squared is even. So a cannot be odd, it's very elementary. The square also, a squared is odd implies a is odd. But a squared is even, so that implies a is even. Because a is even, this is of the form 2 times an integer c. So because of this, a squared equal to 4c squared and 4c squared equal to 2b squared. So 2c squared equal to b squared. So b squared is even, so b is even. So this means 2 is root 2 equal to a by b always means a is even, b is even. But then I can cancel the factor 2, because 2 appears in the numerator and 2 appears in the denominator. So again it is a form some a1 by b1. So you can cancel off all the 2, but still you will be left with something. And that is again factor 2. Then you can, given a fraction, you can remove all the common factors. But now you will, so if a and b are such that they don't have any common factor, you end up with the fact that a and b are even, so they have a common factor too. So in his famous book, in the famous little book, the English mathematician G.H. Hardy, he starts the book with this description. And he says, of course he gives one more example. And with that he says, he writes, 3,000 years of civilization have not written a single wrinkle on this proof. So very beautifully quote. So there are numbers which are not rational. There are other numbers. Now this number has got very interesting features. Rational numbers, you can multiply, you can add, you can subtract, and when the denominator is not 0, when the rational number is not 0, if p and q are two rational numbers, then you can also P/Q division is defined, and P/Q is also rational. Okay? The rational numbers form a closed arena where you can play the following games. You can take two of them, multiply, you will be in that ground, you won't go out. If you add, you will be there. If you multiply, if you divide, if you subtract, you are still there. Such a closed ground where addition, multiplication, division, they do not take the number out of the field, such a closed set is called a field. I'll be a little loose in my language. So all rational numbers make a field where you can play a lot of games. All rational number, we call it simply, we view it as a noun. So all rational make a field. But there is a number outside this field. Now suppose I choose two rationals P and Q and then form P plus Q root 2, P and Q rational. If you add two numbers of this form, you will get again a number of this form. I consider all numbers with the property P plus Q root 2 that P, Q are rational. Add two of them, you get a number of the same form. Take difference, you get the same form. Multiply two, you get the same form. But now what happens if I divide? P plus 2 root 2, say R plus S root 2. Two such numbers from this ground I take. I divide, the P, Q, R, S are rational. Now, this number, I rewrite it as, divide by, I write it as R minus S root 2, and then write R minus S root 2. So, what is the denominator? R squared minus S squared into 2. So, the denominator is R squared minus 2 S squared. And the numerator is the product of the two, so that is again of the form A plus B root 2. But this is rational, A is rational, therefore A by that is rational. So this is a number of the form, say some B dash, which is A by this plus B by this, that is a rational number, B. Q dash, B by this I call as Q dash, which is a rational number, and then as a root 2. So if I divide one by the other, you get again the same number, a number of the same form. So you have a rational, you have all the rationals, and I have included the root 2 in this field, and I have enlarged the field, so I have a bigger field. And you can extend fields in various ways. There is an you can go on extending fields, and it is a very, very interesting algebraic game. Extension of fields. But really, there are also fields of other kind. For example, take just two numbers 0 and 1. I define following rules. 0 plus 0 is equal to 1 plus 1 is equal to 0. And then 0 plus 1 equal to 1 plus 0 is equal to 1. These are the rules by which I define the operation. 0 into 1, 1 into 0 is equal to 0. 1 into 1 is equal to 0. No, of course, I don't divide by 0. So 1 by 1 into 1, 0 by 1 into 0. So I have addition, multiplication, division just with two numbers. So that is a ground which has only two elements, in which I can add, multiply, divide, and they all obey the usual rules. Namely, if I take two numbers B and C in this case, and then add according to this rule, and then multiply by a third number of the same rule, then you will have AB plus AC. Of course, addition, multiplication, they all commute. They produce, they are all commutative operations. And multiplication is a distributive operation. And if you have some non-zero element, it is also inverse. So you can do that. So these two numbers make a field. But what is interesting about this field, it is used in modern technology. Your computer works with a logic based on this particular field. Another interesting way in which these two numbers play a very important role is in encoding and sending messages. How do they do? If you have, suppose you have k messages. K messages are there. And suppose k is of the form, say, it is greater than or equal to 2 to the power l minus 1, but less than 2 to the power n. K is number of this form. Now, you consider all l length sequences of zeros and ones. So that means I consider x1, x2, etc., xn. This is a verb. And each xj is either 0 or 1. So this can be chosen in two ways, this in two ways, and this in two ways. So there are 2 to the power n such sequences. So pick up from this k such sequences. So the messages are written with those words. So the k messages, 1, 2, etc., message 1, etc., message k. They are now translated into, say, the message I message here. It is some xi 1, xi 2, etc., xi, xi n. So, this is written as this word. Then what do I do? I choose a random sequence. What do that I mean? So what do I mean by that? Namely, you take a coin, toss. If head comes, you put 0. If tail comes, you put 1. So toss the coin L times. Do this. Then you get Z1, Z2, etc. Z1. This is obtained by coin tossing. Now, there are two stations. A is here. Nowadays they call it Alice. And there is Bob here sitting. And then he sends the message. And he sends the message I. And then it goes to a certain box. It is called encoder. What does it do? First of all, A and B make an agreement. They meet one day and this number Z1, Z2, etc., Zn, they keep in their diary. Right? So it is a common keyword for both A and B. They know this word Z1, Z2, etc., Zn, which is obtained by coin toss. Now, message I is to be sent. Message I is here. So what this does is, let me call this as Z with a bar. And let me call this as XI with a bar. So what this does is, this encoder adds this Z. According to this logic, according to this plus rule, namely, what comes out what comes out is that plus epsilon. That means this is the word z1 plus xi1, z2 plus xi2, zl plus xin. This is m coder, and then what does this do? This is a decoder. When it passes through, this again adds again the word z. He has a certain key, he presses and it immediately adds z. So what comes out, z plus xi goes in, and he knows this z key, presses the z key, it adds. But now what he gets is z plus xi plus z. But z plus z is 0. So what he gets is the message xi. So the word xi, the ith word is transmitter, which is xi. This is the dictionary, coding dictionary. This word is received. So the ith message. So when xi is received, he reads the message i. So he sends the message i, and b receives the message i. But in between, somebody wants to read. Suppose he taps here, he will get something which is not easily understood. So this is what is called an element of cryptography. So this field plays a very important role, and there are much more sophisticated methods of adding and subtracting in various ways words of this form, and it forms a whole subject called coding theory. So very simple things in mathematics can sometimes be fruitfully or destructively used. Sometimes you can send a secret message to bomb a certain place. It destructive you. Sometimes you can communicate important messages of use to each other. Now my next example. I have difficulties in reading, so I have changed my glasses. The numbers in the form p plus q 2, they are known as certs. So that also is taught in some schools, but generally in school books on arithmetic, it is omitted. Now, rationals can be counted, you saw. Pairs of rationals can also be counted. So, p plus q root 2, they also can be counted. But now, there is a set where you cannot count. Okay, there, that is the set of real numbers or set of all numbers in the interval of 0 to 1. But what is meant by real number, that is a very big story, which we cannot explain within this short time. But normally it is something which only mathematicians learn. Other people do not learn. They see, they feel the numbers and then work with the numbers. Right? And then what they come to know is that number, what all people come to know by working, is that numbers have decimal expansion. This is used everywhere. Now the thing is, numbers not only have decimal expansion, they also have what are called binary expansion, which is extremely useful. That is, we are using only 0 and 1. Namely, suppose you have this segment 0 to 1. Here this intuitive feeling that every number is marked. Suppose this is a number x. And I want to expand it in what is called binary notation. Normally in decimal notation, when you have a number between 0 and 1, you can put a 0 point, some x1, x2, x3, etc. Where each xi is either 0 or 1 or 9. So every number can be expanded in decimal form. This you work with it. You work with such an expansion in schools. But in binary expansion, what do you do? You cut this interval into two pieces. So this is closed interval at half. This is closed interval from 0 to half. And then this is from half to 1. Now this number x is here to the left. So I put here 0 point. Because it is to the left, I put a 0 here. But if this number x is here, I enter a 1. Now, okay, suppose I choose this number. The first one is 0. Now I cut this into two pieces in the same way. Now this is to the right, so I will put a 1 at the second stage. Now at the third stage, I again, because the x is here, now I cut this into 2, and now this is to the left, so that will be 0. And you go on doing this. Of course, sometimes it may be an end point. And when it is an end point, you will get a 1, and then afterwards it will all be 0. But it may also be unending. So every number can be expressed in, that is, every number is now encoded as a sequence of zeros and ones, and it is written as 0.0101, etc. in this way. But its actual value, if you want to compute to any desired accuracy, it is 0 by 2 plus 1 by 2 square, because of this cutting, it is 1 by 2 square plus 0 by 2 cube plus next one, say, suppose this is 0, then this is 0 by, that is, wherever it is 0, you can omit 0 by 2 to the 4, and then suppose 1 occurs at the 18th position, then till then it is 0, you can move it, and at the 18th position it is 1 by 2 to the power 18, and like that you go. So it is this number, and this can be summed up. There is a method by which you can sum up this, and this point which is on the between 0 and 1 is encoded in this way. So every point has a code in terms of 0 and 1. But some points are ending with 1 and then afterwards completely 0. But that can be replaced. It is like this. Point 1 you can also write as 0.099999. So here also in a similar way, if there is, suppose 0.1000, etc. I can write as 0.0 and then 111. That is, 1 occurs infinitely often. Every point can be encoded by a sequence like this, where 1 occurs infinitely often, infinitely many times. Then the coding becomes unique. Now, my claim is, all the points between 0 and 1 that cannot be enumerated. That is, it is not a countable set, but it is an uncountable set. Why? It's a very simple argument. I will give only part of the argument because to save words and energy. How do you do that? Suppose the first number is encoded. Suppose the set is countable. Then the first number is written as A1, encoded like is A11, A12, A13, etc. There is an enumeration table, and then I write A21, A22, A23, etc. Then like that I go AN1, AN2, AN3, etc. So you can each point, suppose this all the elements in 0 to 1 can be encoded into a sequence. And this is the entire table of points in 0 to 1. But now I look at the following. If A11 is 0, I put 1. If A11 is 1, I put 0. Similarly, so I will call it like this. I write a new sequence, A11 prime, A22 prime, A33 prime, etc. Where AJJ prime equal to 1 if AJJ is 0. Equal to 0 if AJJ is 1. And now you look at this sequence. Now I know that this sequence is different from this because A11 prime is different from A1. This is also different from this because A22 prime is different from A2. So like that, if I take, this is not the nth sequence because this is ANN here, but at the nth position this is ANN. So this sequence is outside the table. But you have to look at this argument with a little more care. So the important point is the interval, the set of points in the segment 0 to 1 is uncountable. It cannot be enumerated. This is the first set which was seen in this particular, in this way, in this particular context by a mathematician by the name Cantor. He asked the question, when are two sets of the same size? If you have two sets, I am not defining the word set, that will lead us to write a volume. So, but you understand, you have a different concept of set. So you have two sets A and B. Suppose to every point A, I can choose a point B in here, and then I have A B. A goes to A. This is a way of selection. F is a map from A into B. So that F A, if I choose two elements, A1 and A2, A1 and A2, F A1 not equal to F A. Suppose such a map exists, then I say that A is smaller than or equal to B. Similarly, suppose A is less than or equal to B and B is less than or equal to A. Suppose both of them hold, then one can show if this happens, there exists a map here so that F. This map is such that A goes to F here every point in me is reached. Okay? It is called an onto map or subjective map, but I don't want to introduce too many terms and all that. But the point is, it should be a one-one map, as here. A is mapped to B, B is mapped to A. Then I say that A and B have the same number of points. But for example, if I take 1, 2, 3, etc., and I take only the even integers, 2, 4, 6, 8, etc. We say that these two sets have the same number of points, because I can put the correspondence here, 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 4, 3 goes to 6, and so on. And similarly, you can put 2 goes to 1, 4 goes to 2. This is a projective map, this is a correspondence. This is that. 1, 1 correspondence. But this is also a subset of that. But a set can be a subset of that, but still they may have the same number of points in this sense. Namely, there is a map, a 1-1 map, 1-to-1 correspondence between points A and B, between points of A and points of B. Then, if that happens, one says that A and B have the same cardinal number. Now, you have on the one hand 1, 2, 3, etc. The cardinal number of this is said to be is called the countable cardinal. Is usually denoted by a funny symbol called half round. Right? The unit interval also has a cardinal number, which is uncountable. So this set is bigger than this set in this notation, but it is strictly bigger. You cannot enumerate that. You cannot put this, you cannot construct a map F from here, which is 1-1, but and also on to this 1-2-3, etc. So this set is bigger than this. And Cantor asked the question, is there a set between these two, which is strictly greater, whose cardinal number is strictly greater than that of this, but strictly less than? And he proposed an axiom, he proposed a hypothesis which is called continuum hypothesis. Namely, there is no set in between the set of countable, there is no cardinal number between the countable cardinal and this is called the continuum. And cardinal of the continuum. In between these two, there is no cardinal number. This was a hypothesis he proposed. And this was solved not long ago. In the 1960s, it was proven that you can neither prove this nor disprove this. This is a peculiar statement, into which also we cannot go in easily. Does there exist a cardinal between these two? This question. This can neither be answered in the positive nor be answered in the negative. That is, you can assume that there is no cardinal number between these, and still you can go on in your world with your usual arithmetic of numbers. Or you can assume, yes, there is a cardinal number, and develop a new arithmetic or some other arithmetic. You can do this. So this is a very peculiar situation where you cannot make a decision. if you can ask a question, but the question cannot be answered. So it is very interesting that very simple, elementary questions with which you start regarding the number lead you to a very deep philosophy. And this deep philosophy was what exactly all these things mean was it is a part of a subject called mathematical logic. And it was put on a firm footing by a mathematician by name K. Gordon. There was a great German mathematician by name Hilbert. He was completely shattered by what Gödel said in mathematical logic, because if you have done Euclidean geometry and you have learnt about axioms, there is something called the Playfair axiom, right? Through any point, if you have a line through another point, there goes only one parallel. You can assume that, or you can also dislodge it, but you have one kind of geometry if you assume the Playfair axiom, and if you throw away the Playfair axiom, you can develop another geometry. So, while laying the foundations of geometry, Hilbert claimed that a particular geometry can be developed which is self-consistent. That is, you go on applying the rules of logic and go on proving theorem, and you won't get a contradiction. But such a statement can neither be proved nor be disproved was the result of Gödel's research. So after this theorem, after Gödel came out with this theorem, Hilbert was completely shattered. That the foundations of geometry with its own closed set of axioms, you will have a closed set of axioms. Based on that axiom, you can ask a question. But there will always remain questions which can neither be answered nor be answered in the positive or answered in the negative. Such questions will always remain. Right? Now, Pythagoras' theorem has another very important practical. What is time?
We have 15 minutes. You have 15 minutes.
15 minutes. So I want to come to something practical. Another. This is going very abstract into the logic of the very logical structure of mathematics with the help of the ordinary number system with which we started. Another one, a very practical thing which arises from Pythagoras' theorem is the following. You all know how to use graph sheets, which you use in school. If you take the plane and you use a graph, then every point you go x units here, y units above, and then you get a point and you denote it by the two coordinates x, y. In this you learn to make many graphs. And if you choose two points, x1, y1 and x2, y2. Now what is the distance between the two? So if you drop the perpendicular here and if you drop the perpendicular here, this distance is x1, this distance is x2, so this distance is x2 minus x1. This distance is y1, this distance is y2, so this distance is y2 minus y1. So here is a right angle triangle, and this is x2 minus x1, this is y2 minus y1. So what does Pythagoras' theorem say? that the distance between these two, the square of that, this distance square is this square plus this square. So x2 minus x1 square plus y2 minus y1 square over half, that is root of this. That is the distance between these two points. This is a consequence of Pythagoras theorem. And this has got enormous implications in the whole of mathematics. Here, go to the three dimensions. In three dimensions, you will have three coordinates, x coordinate, y coordinate, and z coordinate. And you have x1, y1, z1, x2, y2, z2. And you ask in space, what is the distance between the two? It is x2 minus z1 square, y2 plus y2 minus y1 square, plus z2 minus z1 square, root. Now why stop with 3? You can have one more, x1, x2, again, I need not stop anywhere, right? x1, x2, x3, x4, y1, y2, y3, y4, these are coordinate points, they may have some physical significance, and I can still write this distance. So you can introduce distances in various spaces. And when you learn triangle geometry, you learn one fact, that the sum of the two sides of a triangle is always greater than the third side. So what you can do is, you can have some universe of points. And then you have two points, x and y. And you can have a bound associated with that, and the positive number when the points are different, a number dxy, called the distance between the two. I say it is distance between the two, not distance of y from x and distance of x from y. So such things also happen in statistics. Distance of y from x can be different from distance of x from y. Such a thing can happen in statistics. But here I am saying distance between. So dxy equal to dyx. And if I take three points, they obey what is called CD, is that? So you have 3 points, and you always have, suppose this also is true, dxy is greater than, is less than or equal to dz plus dzy. This is called triangle inequality. Consider an abstract set, and between any 2 points there is a function, that is a distance, dxy is greater than or equal to 0, and dxy equal to 0, if and only if x is same as y. This symbol, if I double F means if and only if. That's simple. If these are fulfilled, then you say you have a metric space. And the physicists are very fond of having metrics. Einstein's special theory of relativity, general theory of relativity, they are all based on study of metrics. Of course, there it is metrics within quotation, because certain rules can be violated. But there is a peculiar quadratic form involved in the physical metrics. Now I want to, this idea which comes from Pythagoras theorem, it gives you a tool. And this tool was discovered by a German mathematician by the name Gauss. And this tool is used every day in statistical laboratories, nowadays in biology, in economics, and particularly every field of activity. And I will conclude with just one simple example. It is how people try to build models to understand phenomena. So, suppose you consider 100 meters race. Each one takes at its maximum effort a certain time to cover 100 meters. Now we consider a set of people with some uniform qualities, namely same kind, more or less the same kind of health, same kind of pulse in the body and so on. But their height and weight you cannot control. So you have the persons who are included in this problem, they have each individual has a height and each individual has a weight. And to run, so H stands for height, W stands for weight. And he or she takes time T, because let us confine it to either completely boys or completely girls, right? Because there is a difference between them. T is the time to complete 100 meters,
yes,
at its maximum efficiency. Now, you propose a model, roughly speaking, T should be proportional to some A times the height plus B times the weight. B can be negative also. Height gives an advantage. To some extent, weight gives an advantage, and beyond that, the weight is a disadvantage. So, but we propose a model that time taken is of the form AH plus BW. There are better models in mechanics, but for the short lecture, I have chosen the simplest one. T is of the form AH plus W. But I don't know this. What are these two numbers, A and B? But I can make experiments. So I make each one of them run at maximum efficiency. So there is one individual. There are individuals marked 1, 2, 3, etc. Yeah? The jth individual has height Hj, weight Wj, and time to complete the race Tj. And our model says Tj equal to A times Hj plus B times Wj. This is according to the model. But there can be some error. So I consider the, if this model is perfectly true, each one of them will be an inversion for any T, H and W. But for these individuals, the error is now Tj minus A times Hj plus B times Wj. It is T1, T2, etc. Tm, that is a certain point. AH1 plus BW1, AH2 plus BW2, and so on. That sequence is another point. And the discrepancy between the two is the distance. So what is the distance? This minus this square summation and then the root. That describes, and if you use the Pythagorean principle, that explains the distance between the two. Namely the square root of this. Now I want to find the A and B, and I have from the experiment, I have this discrepancy. So I will choose the A and B so that this sum of squares is minimum. Choose A and B such that this is B. Which A and B was the question? So choose A and B such that, this is simple for cylinder, this is minimum. You have done something about maximum, minimum. For the in-between, there is calculus which I have completely omitted. And also, we have omitted completely complex numbers. All these we cannot achieve within 1 hour. But to minimize this, you have to different, simplest way, differentiate with respect to A and put A equal to 0. Differentiate with respect to B and put A equal to 0. Then you will get two equations. A and B are two unknown, and you will get two equations to minimize. So if you do that, what do you get? If you differentiate this sigma two times this, and then I differentiate with respect to A. So there will be a coefficient at J outside with a negative sign. So you will have sigma dj and j, that is equal to a times sigma j square plus b times sigma j wj. Similarly, you differentiate now with respect to b. D by dB of this is 0. So then you will have sigma dj wj equal to a times sigma hj wj plus b times sigma wj square. In a convenient notation, you can do for any number. I have just chosen two. You can even do with one, that is very simple. So, I have the coefficient of A here, sigma j square. Then coefficient of B here, sigma j w j. The coefficient of A here, same thing, because it is a symmetric matrix, j w j. And then this is sigma w j square. If you have learned the matrix multiplication up to second order matrices, 12th standard is included nowadays in current syllabus. But the large majority of students will fail in that. That's the problem. A, B. So matrix means this into this plus this into this. The next one, this into this, this into this. That is equal to sigma T and J. In this model, only two parameters A and B are involved. You have A, B, C, D, etc. You will get a big matrix, a big vector, and a big column. So you can solve simultaneous equation in two variables. That already covered in the school syllabus. And that gives you a good estimate for the two coefficients. If the model is true up to that parameter, then determine the parameters by experiment. This is known as Gauss method of least squares. And Gauss used this method to predict the position of an astronomical object in space by knowing various coordinates about the system involved. And he made a good prediction, and of course nowadays you can read these things on from the net. You simply put the Gauss principle of least squares, you will get the whole story about it. I myself came to know about this for the first time when I joined the Indian Statistical Institute in 1956. So now I am sharing the same idea with you. Thank you very much. No, my listening.
You have to shout.
You have to shout or come here. You can ask me, I will be here for a few years.
Yeah.
The question is you talked about either doesn't exist, I mean, whether there does exist or does not exist between end and R. Or
you
end
have
and
to come very close, I think.
Shout. In the talk you said that between natural numbers and real numbers there doesn't exist or does exist, we can't say yes or no. But what about P of
Q? You can assume there is no in-between set and develop one mathematics. You can assume that there exists a set and develop another kind of mathematics.
So my question is, what about the rest? I mean, P of R and P of P of R.
Hmm?
Power set of R and power set of power set of R. In between them.
Yeah.
All
no, they're also
same.
Yes,
same.
Yes.
And another thing you said that if we can do in both system same kind. I mean, mathematics. And why do we need those things?
I don't know the result. Actually, people have not worked. I haven't seen. I haven't seen an alternative mathematics used anywhere.
I'm saying, why do we need those things? I mean, to prove theorems or anything. Why do we need that, okay, there exists something between N and Pn, or there does not exist something between N and Pn? Why do we need those things?
Okay. Why do we need those
things? I mean, why do we need to understand these things?
Why do you need to understand?
Because
that is again curiosity. Why do you, this question you can never answer. It is like, why do you need to prove the existence of God and so on? It is a curiosity which you cannot suppress.
Yeah.
But I have not seen in print another kind of mathematics without the continuum hypothesis. What are its applications and so on? I don't know.
Is it
a
question?
Don't you think, as a student, that it is such a natural question, how many points are there on the line? It must have an answer.
Yeah.
It must have an answer.
Yeah.
So, what Professor KRP is saying is something very unsatisfactory was discovered, and Hilbert was very upset by this, but it was very unsatisfactory. There is a beautiful essay by Gödel himself, which I recommend to you, which is entitled, What is Cantor's Continuum Problem? That's something like that, approximately. You can find it easily. It's a beautiful essay. And in that, he makes jokes of, if you believe it, then this is true. If you believe it, then that is true. And he chooses ludicrous consequences to make a joke of it, in a way. But there is a profound aspect to it, which is this unknowability is unsatisfactory. Now, there is a famous logician, mathematical logician, by name of Hugh Woodin, W-O-O-D-I-N. He's now professor of mathematics and philosophy at Harvard. And he is one individual who doesn't accept that it's unknowable. So he takes the viewpoint that this means our mathematics is simply, we haven't discovered the foundations, the proper foundations. So he wants to enrich the foundations in such a way that the question is settled. Now I'll say one more thing. 15 years ago, he thought the answer was that he thought Cantor was wrong, that there is something in between. And so this Aleph Null is the number of natural numbers. And he thought, I think at that time he thought he had his money on Aleph 2 for the real numbers. So there's one in between. Then I heard him give a lecture 3 years ago at our 50th anniversary of my university, Lancaster University. And it was a one-hour lecture, popular lecture for people. And then halfway through the lecture, I nearly fell off my chair because he's changed his mind. He's like the high priest of mathematical logic. It's almost a religion, as Professor KRP was saying. So what I wanted to say, the question is still actually alive. He is keeping it alive. Hugh Wooden. So it's a fascinating question, and I share this view that there must be an answer somehow. It's such a simple question. But there is a flip side to this, as Professor Pathasarathy said, that in any system of axiom system rich enough to capture arithmetic, there will be questions that you can write down that can't be settled by the axioms. So that's the sort of downside.
For example, you have a more understandable question which people are very much interested. You have a certain problem, you know a solution, you know the answer, but can you devise an algorithm to get at the answer? For example, every integer can be factorized into primes. Every positive integer can be factorized into primes. But is there a sequence of steps? Steps like addition, multiplication, division, can you produce some algorithms in which you know the sequence of steps and you can finally arrive at the solution? Now, the thing is, suppose you have so many steps that to execute the steps you will need, the number of steps needed is bigger than the age of the universe. Then, in a sense, it is useless, right? So, people divide this into two kinds of algorithms. Algorithms which take polynomial time, algorithms which take exponential time. And there are many problems for which one doesn't know the answer. Does there exist a polynomial time algorithm to get at the solution of the problem? So algorithms can be properly formulated. The notion of an algorithm, what are the steps involved, all these things in computer science are very well codified. And finally the question arises, does there exist a polynomial time algorithm? But if it takes exponential time algorithm, this phenomenon can take place. There is a famous joke, the famous statement attributed to Boltzmann in the context of mechanics. There is something called the Poincaré's recurrence theorem. That is, every orbit will come very close to the original point of departure infinitely often. It will come again and again. This is called phenomenon of recurrence. And that is in what are called the, maybe I should not go into too much detail, I'm also tired. He proved a general theorem that in his set of mechanical system, the orbit will come back to the origin infinitely often in its course. Then, but on the other hand, Boltzmann had a theory that the orbit will go in such a way the entropy will always increase and finally maximum entropy state will be reached. So there is a contradiction in this contradiction of the recurrence theorem of Poincaré. And then actually Boltzmann was psychologically also shattered, but his immediate answer was, yes, you may have infinite recurrence, but the time to come to the point of origin, the departure, point of departure, that time may be more than the age of the universe. That was his sense. But these are philosophical questions in which you cannot lose the curiosity anyway.
Okay, thank you.